Hachette Audio presents Get Rooted. Reclaim your soul, serenity, and sisterhood through the healing medicine of the grandmothers. Written and read by Robyn Moreno. To my parents, whose roots grew me, and to my husband and daughters, whose love roots me. Introduction. Tlalawi, tlalpetskawi, in tlaltikpak. It is slippery, it is slick on the earth. Mexica proverb. You're so rooted, gushed Roma, a bubbly energy healer and hairstylist from Seattle. Her business card promised healing from hair to heart. Yeah, you're the only one here who's actually in your body, echoed her sister Antoinette, a laid-back wildlife biologist slash curandera who was leading our retreat in Belize. Our group had just finished an intense meditation where we journeyed down into a cave, real, to ride a jaguar, imagined, to help us break through mental and spiritual blocks. I was feeling a lot of emotions after flying on my fictitious jaguar, but grounded wasn't topping the charts. So when these spiritual sisters zeroed in on my rootedness, I stopped and looked at them curiously, because for most of my life, I have felt really unanchored. As a Gemini, I have a natural airiness that I like to think of as easygoing, but that can present as dreamy or forgetful. Because busy can be my default mode, I've also been called a tormenta and a spinning top since I was always whirling and moving. But if we're going to really get into it, which is why we're here, right? The truth is, I've also had my fair share of life trauma, which had unleashed a wrecking ball right through my emotional foundation. So to say I was working on becoming rooted was an understatement. I had been healing, purging, praying, rooting, and retrieving for the past 240 days as if my life depended on it. Because, well, it had. Just 1 year before arriving in this remote farm in western Belize with these soulful siblings and a circle of curanderas, I'd had a full-on midlife meltdown. For the most part, it was that familiar working mom tightrope walk of trying to do it all that so many parents around the world face. Most of the rom-com elements were there. The charmingly scattered mom who runs maniacally to catch the commuter train after dropping off her adorable kids at daycare. The dependable hubby who's starting to lose his stoic cool after one too many nights waiting for hashtag mom boss to come home from yet another late work dinner. Climactic work scenes, deadlines, firings, bad press, high-stakes deals. The relatable sense that no matter what our scrappy heroine does, she is still spectacularly failing at everything. But the circumstances, the pressure, and the consequences made it all feel deeper and darker than the usual bad mom's comedy. Like that memorable time I hid in the bathroom during our work Christmas party so I could watch my older daughter's preschool holiday recital via FaceTime. I had chosen work over family again, so there I sat on the toilet, watching Lucia sweetly sing Let It Snow, feeling guilty as I gulped a glass of white wine that I was balancing on the toilet paper dispenser, wondering what I was doing with my life. So many signs and so many slips. And yet, I kept running forcefully right through them all. Until that night, I ended up on the floor. I had been helping to organize an important leadership conference, and because budgets were limited, we all took on an overwhelming amount of extra work, with me acting as producer, wrangler, and panel moderator all at once. Our small but mighty team busted our asses, and the event was a rousing success. We had somehow pulled it off again. High on a stage in front of a crowd of nearly 300 people, I closed the conference by giving an inspiring speech. After I got off the stage and took a train ride back to my riverfront town in the Hudson Valley of New York, I met up with a group of friends at a beautiful waterside restaurant to celebrate and decompress with many crisp bottles of Sancerre. It was a festive and well-deserved revelry. And after holding it together for everyone else, all I wanted to do was drink myself silly and just fall apart. Which is just what I did 5 hours and 3 bars later, when I drunkenly fell off my stool trying to take a group selfie and smashed my nose on a table. I blurrily remember people looking down at me, friends, my husband, and even my daughters, because somewhere in the merriment, I had convinced my husband Lars and our kids to join me. Recognizing that that was the end of the party, we quickly left and went home. And I faintly remember sloppily hugging the girls goodnight before I staggered to our bed and passed out. The next morning, I woke up with a pounding headache and crusted blood on the front of the beautiful boho dress I was still wearing from the day before. It wasn't even my dress. I had borrowed it for the event. Panicked, I ran to the bathroom and gasped when I looked in the mirror and saw a jagged gash on my nose and fear in my eyes staring back at me. "It's okay, it's okay, it's okay," I kept saying to myself like a mantra to calm the rising horror in my chest as I reached into the cabinet to grab some aspirin. "It's okay, it's okay, it's okay," I repeated as I gingerly lifted my dress over my head, careful to avoid my injured face. "It's okay, it's okay, it's okay," I chanted as I turned on the faucet to run the stained fabric under cold water. But as I watched rusty blood seep out of the dress and spiral in slow motion down the drain, I had a thought as firm as a bathroom sink I was gripping. I am not okay. The Mexica called the world slippery slick. Aztec is a word given by scholars to refer to the rulers of ancient central Mexico who spoke Nahuatl. But the Aztecs never called themselves Aztecs, instead referring to themselves as the Mexica. They believed the world was an unstable place, a place where you could trip and fall, either from your own poor judgments or from the inherent slipperiness of life. In the Florentine Codex, an account of Mexica life compiled by the Franciscan missionary Bernardino de Sahagún, a mother warns her daughter, "The earth is not a place of contentment. It is a place of joy with fatigue, of joy with pain." This concept might be new to you, but I'll bet it feels familiar. We're happily walking along in our lives when, bam, curveballs come from every corner. We lose our jobs, loved ones betray us, and we surprise ourselves with our own weaknesses, our ugly anger, our scary ability to hurt and to be hurt. We've all experienced the world's slickness in our own different ways. It's our friend who senselessly cheats on her loving husband, the neighbor who's abusing Adderall to keep up with her busy life, or the cousin who's overdrawn her account because of the shopping addiction she just can't seem to quit. Slippery slick is that "fuck, here we go again"-ness that heaves you over the edge of a cliff, propelled by your own internal pain, broken promises, or other outside forces, like, say, a global pandemic that strikes out of nowhere and drop kicks all of our perfectly laid out and sweat-drenched dreams right into the dirt. Yep, the world is slippery, all right. Yet as gruesome as that bathroom moment was for me, when fear and shame kept pummeling me in waves, I grasped on to something rooted deep within me. I didn't know what it was called then. I just felt its pulsing, hopeful signal sent from somewhere ancient and far below that whispered there could be another way. Another way to work. Another way to mother. another way to walk on the slippery, slick path. So, clinging on to that life raft of a possibility, I began to get rooted. I have always been a spiritual seeker, lighting candles to La Virgen de Guadalupe while simultaneously studying Eastern religions and philosophies. In my 30s, I became a yoga teacher and life coach. My shelves are lined with self-help books with wisdom from people I love and admire, from Michelle Obama to Dr. Clarissa Pinkola Estes. But something in that bathroom moment screamed out an urgent SOS, and mercifully, something closer to home answered back. In that cosmic Big Brother way, you might just think, my kid is growing out of her shorts, and suddenly ads for Target start popping up everywhere. I started to see messages all centered around curanderismo, an earth-based healing tradition that blends the beliefs, medicine, and practices of indigenous people of the Americas, Africa, and Europe, and their respective histories, and utilizes energetic cleansing, herbs, heart-to-heart talks, touch, sound healing, prayer, and much more to help balance your emotions, spirit, and body. A year prior, my cousin Patty, who was studying to be a curandera, asked one of her instructors to come to New York City to teach a small group of people, including me, the art and wisdom of curanderismo. Even though I was dizzy with the stresses of work and family, something unclenched in me during the session. I had felt at home with the teachings and the tools because my great-grandmother had been a practicing curandera. Now, I began to feel that call coming from deep inside. Can I heal whatever is going on with me and my family by learning the medicine of my grandmothers, I wondered. And with that guiding question in mind, I set out. Eventually, I resigned from my job, switching back to a freelance career that was more freeing but less financially steady. I knew it was a precarious and privileged decision to walk away from that manic hashtag mom boss life, but I did it. I began to study curanderismo with a 65-year-old chingona badass reverend. Among the many life-changing things she taught me was the concept of ser, your true essence, the whole and unbreakable.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.